for by grace you have been saved through faith. But what exactly is faith? Sometimes it can be a challenge to define. What does faith look like day to day? How is my faith put on display at work or when I'm around my friends and family? Is my faith even real? How do I know that I have an authentic faith? Thankfully, our God doesn't always leave us with unanswered questions. We can have a peace that passes all understanding because God speaks to us through His Word. And He tells us how we can have an authentic faith.
Feels just like falling in love. Feels just like I'm faith.
Well, good morning. If we haven't had the opportunity to meet yet, my name is Terry Lee, and I'm one of the pastors here at the Oaks Church. Whether you call the Oaks your church home or this is your first time here, we are so glad that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. We're going to be continuing our study in the book of 1 John, and so if you have a Bible, go ahead and find the letter of 1 John. You can head to the very back of your Bible and kind of head a couple pages left, and you'll stumble onto 1 John there. If you don't have a copy of God's Word, we would love nothing more than to put one in your hands. And so as you leave this morning, just grab one from the Connect table. That's our gift to you. We'd love to resource you any way that we can to help you hear from God through His Word. Now, as we get into 1 John this morning, we come to chapter 5, the last chapter of this letter. And what John is going to do this morning is kind of bring us into almost a courtroom-like setting. So maybe some of you love courtroom dramas, right? You love the fact that you kind of know the behind-the-scenes details that the jury is hearing as it comes on the scene, and you just eat that stuff up, right? Or maybe you've recently got to serve in jury duty, and that you're kind of like, all right, you know, serving my country, doing my duty, getting paid like $3 an hour to be here instead of work, right? But what John is going to do, as he's done throughout this book, is he's going to give us a series of questions to help us determine if our faith is authentic. As you kind of know the context of this book at this point, if you've been here, John is writing, he's probably late in his 80s, he's the last surviving apostle of Christ at this point, and there have been some false teachers who have come into the church. And so a lot of the Christians in the church that John pastored were questioning the authenticity of their faith. And so John's trying to encourage them. He wants them to kind of put their faith on trial and see that there are a series of tests that prove their faith is genuine. At the same time, in the second half of the scriptures we'll look at this morning, he puts the Christology of Christ, so what is believed about Christ and what Jesus said about himself, he's going to bring that up on trial. And he's going to let us kind of be the jury and the opponents of what John was teaching. He's going to let them be the jury in this setting. And he's going to bring up five witnesses that are going to say Jesus is who he said he is. So as we look at this passage, what I want you to see is that the Bible is extremely accessible. It flows really easily as we look through a passage like this. And at the same time, we're going to get to a couple points that some scholars have said the most difficult to interpret passage in all of Scripture, which makes my job super fun and the time we get to spend together here really exciting, because we believe that the Lord speaks through His Word. If we were to just kind of summarize these verses here that we're going to look at, I would simply tell you that authentic faith can be observed in our lives and obtained by faith in Jesus. All right, so authentic faith is something that can be seen by other people. It's something that can be observed. So a lot of people may say that they have an authentic faith and a relationship with God. And what John is going to say is, no, it's actually something you can see, too. It's something that it's observed in the way that you view God and other people. Now, you may be wondering, okay, well, how do I have a faith like that? Is it something that I need to do? Even as we made the video for this, we wanted to put some things in there, like someone praying through the rosary. Someone, you know, like, what does it mean? What do I have to do to have an authentic faith? And what we're going to see is that an authentic faith is a gift that is obtained by believing and trusting in Jesus Christ. As Logan prayed, not of your own doing, but what has already been done on your behalf. So with that being said, I want to jump into these first five verses here, and then we'll begin hearing what God has to say to us this morning. Verse 1, John writes, "Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God. And everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God?" So what does this show us, these first five verses? Well, this teaches us that our salvation needs regular examination. Our salvation, our relationship with Christ, should be regularly examined. That's what John is inviting the church to do here. Not so that they would all doubt their faith, but so that they would have a thriving relationship with God. Our faith needs to be examined. Maybe you think about the last time that you went to the doctor. There are a couple reasons to go to the doctor, right? Maybe it's because your elbow's just really been hurting, and you're like, I don't know why it's bothering me so bad. Maybe you've had a cough for a while, or you're just not feeling good, and so you go to the doctor, and you say, hey, I have this specific thing wrong with me. I need you to kind of help. You know what the issue is going in. But there are other times that you just go for an annual checkup, right? And so they put the cuff on your arm and they pump it until you feel like it's going to split your arm in half. And you're like, they're like, okay, everything checks out. And you're like, good. And then sometimes they look at your blood work or something and they're like, hey, we need to change your diet a little bit. And you're like, oh, didn't realize that was a problem. Good to know going forward. Okay, and so that's what John is going to do here. He's going to say, hey, there may be some areas that you don't know about. Maybe some areas that you're anxious about, and the Word of God is going to say, hey, you're doing a good job. Keep it up. And then there are other areas that you feel like are totally fine. And the Word of God speaking by the power of the Holy Spirit is going to come to you and say, hey, let's work on this. Your identity as a child of God is to not participate in things like that. So let's grow in that. And so we need to examine our faith. This is a healthy thing to do that the Word of God invites us to do. As we've seen, John kind of gives three tests throughout the book of 1 John, and here he's going to combine all three. The doctrinal test, what do you believe? The social test, how do you love others? And the moral test, how do you live? And so from now on, for the rest of your walk with the Lord, when you come to 1 John, you need to kind of be thinking, all right, there are three tests in this book, right? That's why we say it every week. You're like, okay, doctrinal, what do I believe? Social, how do I love others? How do I live with others? And moral, right? How do I personally live? So first, the question is, do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God? It's a doctrinal test he gives right here in the first verse. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God. Now, whenever he uses that language of being born of God, he's talking about what happens to you when the Holy Spirit illuminates the gospel, when the Holy Spirit makes clear, speaks in a language you can understand, that you are a sinner in need of a Savior, and that Jesus is that Savior, that you were born dead in your sins, and the only way that you could have life it is if it was given to you by one who laid down his life and then was resurrected to give you that life, right? If you believe, according to this passage, that Jesus is the Christ, that he is the Son of God in the flesh, then you have been born again. Now, this is important because perhaps some of you are thinking, you know, whenever whatever, I share my testimony with people, I wrestle because I don't have kind of this moment where it just seems like my life was in complete darkness and then God just came in and flipped the switch and then it was like, oh, like I'm a brand new person. It happened on that day, at that time, at that camp, in that location, sitting in that chair, and you struggle. And you're like, well, I don't really know. Now, the important thing is that John doesn't just keep this as a past tense. What can you look at? Was there a specific moment? No, he brings this into the present tense, doesn't he? He says, everyone who believes right now, what are you believing right now about the Son of God? Because your belief in the present is what determines what has happened in the past. He says, if you believe, then you have been born of God. I think it was Adrian Rogers who once used the illustration, you know, if you're driving in a car, whenever you cross from, you know, one state line to the other, you know exactly when it happens, right? If you're driving from Ohio to Kentucky, as soon as you go in, you kind of see that welcome sign, welcome to Kentucky. But if you were to fly from Columbus to Louisville, that's how you say it if you've lived there, Louisville, you have to say it like that. If you fly from Columbus to Louisville, you get out of the plane and you're like, well, I don't know exactly when it happened, but I know this is where I'm at now. And so what John is saying is, look, whenever you're asked where your belief is on Jesus Christ, you shouldn't just say, well, you know, I was baptized whenever I was 7, or it was this, you know, experience I had at camp where I just knew. And those things can be great spiritual markers in your faith. But he says the most important thing in determining what you believe about Jesus Christ is what you believe right now. Do you believe that he is the Son of God, substitute in your place right now? Whenever you sin, do you trust Jesus? Do you go to Jesus and say, I want to confess this because I believe you're a Savior for me in this moment, right now? I think also if we're going to talk about belief in Christ, we need to have a firm understanding of what belief actually is. To believe in Jesus is not to just kind of say, yeah, I accept these facts about him. Let us remember James 2:19. That says, even the demons believe, right? So if Satan was to somehow walk into my systematic theology class that I took in seminary, he would probably get a better grade than me, right? Because he knows so much about God. He can affirm so many things about Christ. Yet what is the difference in someone who actually believes with their whole life and someone who just says, yeah, these are details, facts that I know about Jesus? Well, it is to place your full trust on Jesus. It's an example you've probably heard before, but to place your faith in Christ is to put the whole weight of your life in Christ. And much like you're sitting in the chair, the moment that you have faith is whenever you choose to sit down. It doesn't mean that you stand beside the chair and you recite facts about it and you sing about it and you come on Sunday morning to look at the chair for a couple hours, but you never sit in it, right? If we truly have faith in Christ, we put all of our weight of our sin, of our guilt, of our shame, of our unrighteousness, and we say, I believe that only Christ can save, and we put the whole weight of our life upon him. And some of you are thinking, well, I still have a lot of questions. I still wrestle with maybe not knowing enough. Maybe this quote from Tony Evans is helpful. He says, don't worry about how much faith you have. Worry about what you place it in. You see, if you have great faith in your religious accomplishments, that will do nothing for you before God. If you have great faith in the fact that you were raised in a Christian home and even went to a Christian school, that will do nothing for you before God. But if you have great faith in the Savior, Lord Jesus Christ, or even the faith of a mustard seed, it is enough to be saved. And this is why we read John 14:6. And Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to me, or no one comes to the Father except through me. Now that tells us what truth? That there is only one way to the Father, and that is through Jesus. Now I'm going to say something that sounds extremely controversial. There is only one way to the Father except through Jesus, but there are many ways to Jesus. All right, so Jesus is the only way, yes, but there are many ways that people come to Jesus. And maybe you can think about your own life, right? Maybe someone just kind of handed you a Bible, and so you're like, well, you know, I don't know much about this. I'm just going to start reading, and maybe that's how God brought you to faith. Maybe some of you had a friend who was just kind of speaking into your life or invited you to church or said, hey, let's hang out at my missional community or something like that. You need to know that, because if the only way to God is through Jesus, then that means we want to be people who tell others about Jesus. And we also recognize that there are many ways for people to come in contact with who Jesus is. And so as you're thinking about Sports Saturday or park nights or summer seminary or lunch times that you have in between work, you can use these things to lead people to know who Jesus is. I want to keep going here. What do we need to believe about Jesus? John tells us that Jesus is the Christ. What does that mean? A lot of times we hear Jesus Christ and we think, okay, so Jesus had a first and last name, right? First name Jesus, last name Christ. That kind of makes sense. But if we look a little closer and we have kind of the Old Testament scriptures in mind, what we'll see is that Christ was the title given to the one who was prophesied about, who would be the Son of God to take on flesh. And so what we believe, what has to be said about Jesus to have real belief, is that he is indeed second person of the Trinity, Son of God, eternally existing, and at the same time, who took on flesh to receive the name Jesus, to be born of Virgin Mary, conceived by the Holy Spirit. We have to believe these things, that Jesus is both God and man, fully, 100% of both. Now, you may be thinking, well, I mean, that kind of just sounds like theological stuff. And if I'm really sincere about wanting to follow the teachings of Jesus, if I believe he was like a really good person, do I really need to know all of that kind of stuff about him? You do. Guys, I want you to imagine that you were to write a poem about your wife, right? You know, Valentine's Day is coming up or something. You're like, I'm going to write a poem about my wife. And so you write about her long blonde hair and her green eyes that just shine like emeralds, and, you know, how tall she is. And you write, just really pour your heart into it, right? So sincere. And you give it to your wife. And the problem is, she has brown hair and brown eyes, and she's not tall. How is she going to respond? Not well, right? Not a good move. Don't do it. And so whenever we come to Jesus and we're like, oh, Jesus, we love you. We love your teachings. But the resurrection, I mean, in the body? I mean, I don't know. I don't know if I can fully believe. That is not honoring to him. That is not biblical. That does not prove authentic faith. And so what John is saying here is you need to examine your faith and see if I really believe that Jesus is the Son of God. And if you want to see that, look at the pages of Scripture. Second test in examining our faith, do you love others? Do you love other people? He continues in verse 1. And everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of him. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love and obey his commandments. Now, we've talked about loving people so much in this book, right? And some of you guys are thinking, like, if he tells me to love other believers one more time, I'm just going to walk out. Don't do it, okay? We are called to love one another. That puts the gospel on display. But I want you to see how he defines one of the best ways that you can love other people. And it's kind of unexpected. He says, "By this we know that we love the children of God." How, John? "When we love God and obey his commandments." According to John, one of the primary ways you can love your brothers and sisters in Christ is by obeying the commandments of God. Can you kind of see how his logic would be working here? If you were to truly view your integrity, and if you were to take the command of God to never tell a lie, how much better would your relationships with other people get? If you said, you know what, I'm going to look at this vertically, and I want to honor God, and so I'm not going to tell a lie because he commands me not to. Imagine how much better every relationship you have would be if they were firmly built on trust. If people could know every word coming out of your mouth is completely honest. Let's look at something like lust, right? The Ten Commandments say, do not commit adultery. And then Jesus says, if you've committed lust in your heart, you've committed adultery. So let's just say, all right, if you never lusted again because you were just honoring God, how would that affect your other relationships? It would mean you would never objectify someone who is created in the image of God again. It means that you would not have the capacity to harm your spouse in that way by comparing them to other people. Do you understand how loving God by obeying his commands loves other people? If you worked as to the Lord in the workplace, imagine how your fellow employees, the clients you have, would be lifted up simply by you saying, the best way I can love other people is by loving God and obeying his commands. That's a great way to think through this passage. So why is it that we struggle so much to obey oftentimes? I think it's because we don't trust God like we should. I don't want to spend too much time here, but there's a relation between trust and obedience, isn't there? Right? The more that you trust someone, the more you are apt to listen to what they say. And so whenever I, you know, tell my child not to do something, his obedience toward me is based upon his trust of my word. And our obedience toward God is based upon our trust of his word. So what's going to make us more obedient to God? It is by trusting him. Which is why it's important. He goes on, verse 3, "For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome." The commands of God are not burdened. Whenever you read the Bible, whenever you think about the kind of things that you hear preached on Sunday morning, do the commands of God feel like burdens, or do they feel like you're being loved by God? That's an important thing to think through. Whenever you get your giving statement at the end of the year, right, and you see that number, do you feel burdened, or do you feel excited to be a part of the mission of God? Do you think like, man, that could have been, you know, a week-long vacation, and, you know, I gave it to the church? Or do you think, I'm getting to be a part of something so much bigger than myself by giving, by being generous? Whenever you get that planning center request for a Sunday morning 3 weeks from now, are you thinking like, oh, I wanted to sleep in that morning? Or are you thinking like, this is a way that I get to build up the church. That I get to love the bride of Christ as a part of this bride. Do we view the commands of God as burdensome or as a delight? That's why I had Michaela read that verse and pray through that verse, because the yoke of Jesus is easy and the burden is light. His burden is light to us. We see that. I mean, if you think about the weight of sin, if you think about how burdensome something like addiction is, if you think about how burdensome something is, like falling into a sin that you just feel like there is no way out of, you know this to be true. How is it that we can see that that these are not burdensome? I think it's to understand what is at stake. This weekend, Abby and I and Brooks, we went out to Sharon Woods and we rented a paddle boat. Okay, so it was great. We get out there and they put this life jacket on Brooks that is like squeezing his cheeks out. You know, it's super, super small. He does not like it at all, right? And then we get on the boat and he's like saying like, help, 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 you know, as he's tugging on this thing. And what I wish that I could help him understand is that that life jacket, although it may seem uncomfortable in the moment, is not burdensome. Because that is a way for us to love and protect him. If he knew what could possibly happen if he was to fall off of that boat in his 2-year-old, unable to swim state, he would realize that even what may feel like a constraint on him is actually an act of love. And if he were to fall in the water, he would realize that that is not a burden, but a source of life intended for him to flourish and thrive and continue living. This is why we are given these commands in Scripture, so that our lives would honor the Lord and that we would find great joy in them. Whenever God draws his people out of Egypt through the Exodus, he declares, "You are my people and I am your God." Then he gives the Ten Commandments and says, "Go and live in this way." This is a source of protection and love and guidance for God's people. And yet we do realize that this is still an act of faith. Jerry Bridges says that faith enables us to obey when obedience is costly or seems unreasonable to the natural mind. There are still moments that you love God, maybe even despite the emotional desire to obey, because you ultimately have faith that what God knows is best for you. We trust God in that way. One more thing I want to point out here. This prophecy given in Ezekiel 36, 26, and 27. God tells his people, "I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws." How is it that we will follow his decrees and be careful to keep his laws? Verse 27, "I will put my spirit in you." Why is it not burdensome to keep the commands of God? It's because the Holy Spirit is working in us and through us to keep these commands. And so it is not a burden that we are carrying. The third test he gives here, "Do you have a faith that overcomes the world?" Verse 4 and 5, he'll use the word overcome 3 times. "For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God?" Right, if you have ever wondered where Nike got the name of their company, it comes from this Greek word, overcome, right here, right? The root word that is used 3 times here is the word Nike. It's a way to describe victory, overcoming. And so what John wants us to ask ourselves is, have you had a faith that overcomes the world? There are so many things that the world offers us in an attempt to satisfy us, in an attempt to pacify our desires, in an attempt to just kind of woo us to believing that they have something to offer that would ultimately fulfill our desires. And what we see here is that it is only faith in Christ, that he alone satisfies, that will help us to overcome the sins the world has to offer. So after looking at these 3 tests, let me ask, what does an examination of your salvation produce in you? Is it assurance? Is it doubt? Is it maybe even a renewed pursuit to say, you know what, I see some areas that I feel like the Lord is prompting me to change, and I want to run into that. I want the Holy Spirit to work through me in that. You see, a word would be written again to this very church in Ephesus in the book of Revelation. And what was wrong with them was not their works, but their love for the Lord. Listen to what's laid out here as Jesus addresses the church of Ephesus. He says, I know your works, your toil, and your patient endurance, and how you cannot bear with those who are evil, but have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and found them to be false. I know you are enduring patiently, that sounds great, and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown weary. But I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen. Repent and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. He looks at this church that can list out all these great things that they're doing. And then once again, he says, it seems like you have lost your love for the Lord. Examine that. What are you believing about Christ in this moment? How are you trusting in the gospel right now? How are you loving others? Not to gain God's favor, but because you have received it, and that produces a love for others. And then finally, how are you running from the sins of the world to pursue God? Wherever you find yourself, 1 John 1:9 is a worthy reminder. It says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. How do we know that we have salvation? How do we know we have a relationship with God? If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to cleanse us of our sins, of our unrighteousness. Right? That is what allows us to have a relationship with God, is to be cleansed by Christ and to put faith in his name. Let's go here to verses 6 through 12. And I want you to see that Jesus is the Son of God and we have life in his name. And so the first trial was to kind of look at our own faith. And here this second trial is to look at who Christ is, and to discover if Christ truly is who he says he is. And we will come to the conclusion that Jesus is the Son of God and we have life in his name. Verse 6. This is he, Jesus, the Son of God, who came by water and blood. Jesus Christ, not by the water only, but by the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God, that he has borne concerning his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. And this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. We've seen throughout this letter that what people believe about Christ is kind of being put to the test by some other teachers. The specific teacher who comes to mind, looking through history and who would have been around John and kind of teaching some other things at the time, his name was Cerinthus, or Corinthus, however you want to say it. And he believed that Jesus was born naturally out of wedlock between Joseph and Mary, and they kind of created this story to cover it up. He believed that Jesus received the Spirit of God whenever he was baptized, and right before he was crucified, the Spirit of God left him, and because God wouldn't allow his true Son to go through something like that. All right, so now John, knowing that that is kind of the backdrop of what is being pushed against the church, he says, no, here is this testimony of who Jesus truly is. He says, this is he who came by water and blood. Jesus Christ, not by the water only, but by the water and the blood. All right. Well, people have all kinds of different views here. Some people believe that whenever it says water and the blood, that it's talking about the birth of Christ. Okay, so his incarnation, that whenever a woman is about to give birth, her water breaks and there's blood involved and there's a birth. Okay, there you go. I said it. And then some other people think that the blood and the water is whenever Jesus has the spear thrust through his side and water and blood flow mingled out because his heart, the sac around his heart exploded. And some people see this as a proof of who Christ was, that he really died. And then other people would say that the water and the blood is a picture of the sacraments or the ordinances. So baptism and communion, these are the ways that we commune with Christ now. And then finally, the view that I would hold to is that this is talking about the baptism of Jesus as kind of this proof of who Christ is as the Spirit descends on him and the Father says, "This is my Son with whom I am well pleased." And then the crucifixion, where you see the earthquakes, the sky turns dark, even the Roman soldiers fall to the ground saying, "Who is this man? Surely he is the Son of God." Tombs are opened, dead people are walking out, and John goes, "How's that for proving that he is the Son of God as he says he is?" And I think this is also the only view that kind of takes into consideration the role of the Holy Spirit, because that's the third witness that's mentioned here. The Spirit is the one who testifies because the Spirit is truth. And so you see the Holy Spirit at work throughout the ministry of Jesus as he is raising the dead, as he is healing the blind, causing the crippled to walk, and all of these things to show that indeed the Spirit has testified not only in the ministry of Christ, but also in those who have believed upon his name, that we too are indwelt by the Holy Spirit and have that witness. So, let's just briefly look at each of these witnesses. First, the witness of water baptism in verse 6. Matthew 3, 16 through 17, just so you kind of have a marker in your Bible of where to put this, even though it's mentioned in every gospel, it says, "And when Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him. And behold, a voice from heaven said, 'This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased.'" Now, Cerinthus and the other guys would have said, "Yeah, that's kind of what we saw too." And so that proves that he just receives, kind of became God's special son right then. And that's why John says, "No, this is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He has and always has been Jesus Christ." He didn't become it in that moment. And then he goes on, "Not by the water only." All right, we're not just saying that this was proof in his baptism, but by the water and the blood. The second witness is his crucifixion for the things I mentioned earlier. And this matters, that we see kind of the heavens quake and the temple veil torn from top to bottom, because this proves that Christ was not only who he said he was, but that he is indeed a substitute for our sins. If he was just a good teacher or a moral man, he could not take away the debt and penalty of our sin. This is why John Owen would write, "Christ's blood is the great sovereign remedy for sin-sick souls." Do you realize that our souls are sick with sin? And the only remedy, the only antidote that can be given is the shed blood of Christ in our place. The third witness is the witness of the Spirit in Christ's ministry. I mentioned that briefly, so I'm not going to go through that again. But then John says in verse 9, "If we receive the testimony of men," let's back up, verse 8, "the Spirit and the water and the blood, these three agree." Why would he say that? Well, because any person who had a background in Judaism or just kind of the common courts would know Deuteronomy 19:15, where it says, "One witness cannot establish any wrongdoing or sin against a person. whatever the person has done, the fact must be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. And so John was saying, okay, so you need three witnesses to believe something? I have three. Here they are. And if these witnesses were not good enough, see that God himself is a witness. So number four, the witness of God the Father here in verse 9. He says, if we receive the testimony of men, if you'll believe something just because three guys said it, then how much more should we believe the testimony of God? He says, the testimony of God is greater, for this is the testimony of God that he has borne concerning his son. That God himself spoke and said, this is my son with whom I am well pleased. The fifth and final witness that Jesus indeed is the Son of God and that we can have life in his name is the believer. In this courtroom, the jury now makes the decision that will eternally change them forever. What do you say? It's like whenever Jesus turns to Peter on the mount and says, now, I don't want to know what other people are saying about me. Who do you say that I am? Here we see in verse 10, whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. We become a witness. We become those who give the testimony of who Christ truly is whenever we believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Not just facts out there to be confirmed, but a fact to be received that would eternally change us forever. And he says, if you don't believe this, then you're saying God has himself committed perjury. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar. So if you're in here this morning and you're thinking, well, you know, I'm kind of a bad person, but I don't really need to trust my whole life to Jesus, then he's saying, well, are you calling God a liar? Because he says that you're a sinner in need of a Savior. And if you don't believe that, then you're saying that he has lied. Or you're saying something else that's not true about Jesus and calling God a liar. He says, don't be like that. But instead, verse 11, see the testimony that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Eternal life is both a future hope and a present reality. It is something we are now given, not something you wait for. It is a life of joy and peace with God. It doesn't mean that you won't have any problems anymore. It means that you will have a tower of refuge in the midst of your problems. It doesn't mean that you won't struggle with sin anymore. It means that you now have a sure and steady anchor in the midst of your struggle and an advocate with the Father when you fail him. So we have eternal life now, and it is given to us as a gift. Some of you may be getting your pay stub at the end of this week. And whenever you open up your bank account and you look at that direct deposit, you're not going to see that amount and think, oh, they shouldn't have, you know. Why? Because that's a wage. You work for that. You put in 40, 50, 60 hours. You work for that. So if someone was to say, hey, if your boss was to come up and say, hey, did you get that gift I gave you on Friday? You're going to say, what? No, I earned that. And what John wants us to see is that our salvation is something that is given to us. You didn't earn it. It's not a wage. You didn't work for it. You didn't put in your time doing scripture memory and attending church service and all those things so that you could earn this as a wage. The wage we earned was death. And the gift that we have been given is eternal life in Christ. And to receive that gift, all you must do is believe. As we heard that verse, Romans 10, 9 through 11, read by Logan earlier, we come to the realization that the only prerequisite for coming to Christ is the sin that we have committed that made it necessary. And so we come to Christ and we receive the gift that he has given us through repentance and faith. through simply saying, Lord, I realize that I have sinned against you. You are a holy God, and I am dead. But I repent of my sin, and I put my trust in you as my only hope. And we find great joy that the word here is whoever believes. And for those of you who maybe haven't believed this morning, you say, you know what, I don't know all the answers to every question, but this morning I want to believe. For those of you who have believed, you look at this and you think, if I have received this gift, what is the next step for me to take in loving God, in loving others, and in turning from the world? We see here that the evidence is laid before us, and we can find life in the name of Christ. Let's pray. Father God, you are gracious and merciful to give us your word. Lord, we're thankful for the way that you speak to us. Lord, I pray that you would continue to speak even now. Holy Spirit, I ask that if there are people in this room, Lord, who have maybe tried to clean themselves up and have just found it to be a tiring, impossible task, that you would show them that you have done everything needed for them to be clean and pure, and that they would just come to you and say, God, I want a relationship with you through Christ, and that you would save them now. Lord, for those of us who have been walking with you, perhaps even new to our faith or walking with you for a long time, would you just show us how to respond to your word, to be faithful, because your commands are not burdensome, but are instead an act of your love toward us. We pray all of this in Christ's name. Amen.